I cordially welcome you to our second day of Palmacon 2021. The topic for today's session is spirometry, especially beyond FEV1, FVC, and FEV1 by FVC. To chair today's session, I would like to welcome Dr. S.K. Chhabra. Dr. Chhabra is a reputed physician, respected teacher, and an acclaimed national faculty with huge teaching and research experience. His predominant areas of research and clinical interests are asthma, COPD, ILD, and pulmonary medicine and allied sciences. He has over 130 publications in prestigious international and national journals. He was previously associated with Vallabhbhai Patel Chest Institute for over 3 decades, and presently he is the HOD of Pulmonary Sleep and Critical Care Medicine in Primus Hospital, New Delhi. I welcome you, sir, and I request you to kindly proceed over the session. Thank you.
Thank you for the kind introduction. I would like to thank my friend, Dr. Parthasarathy Bhattacharya, for giving me an opportunity to be associated yet another Palmacon. And this has always been one of the better designed and planned conferences, and this continues even in today's time when we have shifted over to virtual platforms. Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya, and hope that these kind of conferences will go on irrespective of COVID. The topic for today is quite provocative. You know, we have been talking about spirometry in so many workshops, pre-conference workshops. So, and all chest physicians, they have a fair idea about spirometry, although they may not be doing it as it should be done. So today's speaker, Dr. Sandeep Salvi, again, a friend for decades, it's a pleasure to be a chair where he's the main speaker. He's a speaker, a wonderful person with vast knowledge and an insatiable appetite for learning more and more. He's at present director, Palmocare Research and Education, Pune. He's founder director, Chest Research Foundation. He's member board of directors of GOLD, and that is a thing to be proud of for India. He's a former vice president of Indian Chest Society, a member of International Advisory Board of Lancet Respiratory, chair chronic respiratory disease section of the Global Burden of Disease. And a lot of us have read about the Global Burden of Disease papers and his contribution to epidemiology from that. He's a member of the Steering Committee on Air Pollution and Health. He has a huge amount of publications, more than 200 on last count, and endless list of guest lectures. He's among the top 1% of global respiratory scientists. So it's always a pleasure to listen to Dr. Sandeep Salvi. And when he speaks on a chapter on a topic like spirometry, where he's the master. So whether it's a routine lecture, just covering the basics, or the advanced aspects of spirometry, or anything controversial, he's the best person to talk about. So without wasting much more time, I would invite Dr. Salvi to begin his presentation. Dr. Salvi, please.
Thank you, Dr. Chhabra, for those very, very kind words of welcome and introduction. I would also like to express my very sincere thanks to Dr. Parthasarathy Bhattacharya for organizing this this year's Palmacon with the same zeal and enthusiasm as which he has always done in the past. Very, very rich in scientific content and excellent faculty. So it's always a pleasure to be a part of this prestigious Palmacon conference. I feel very honored and privileged to be giving a talk with Dr. Chhabra as the chair. Dr. Chhabra has been a role model for not only for me, but for many of us. And especially his contribution in the field of respiratory physiology has been absolutely immense. So we have learned a lot from him, and to have him be here as a chairman for this session, I feel very honored and privileged. Thank you very much. The today's topic that I'm going to speak on is something that is very fundamental to the lung. and that is understanding how your lung functions. Spirometry obviously is the most important and the most widely used lung function tool. However, there's still a lot of knowledge that needs to be generated in this very important field of spirometry. I'm going to be primarily covering the basics because I think it is important, and also a little advanced, a little more than FVC, a little more than FEV1, and a little more than FEV1 upon FVC ratio, which Dr. Partha Sarthi gave me this title as a topic to speak. Little advancements have taken place over the last 150 years, and they're still evolving. I believe that in the next 5 to 10 years, a lot of advancement will happen in the field of spirometry, and very exciting times, and I'm looking forward to all those new advances that will take place. Well, before I start, I think it's important to appreciate the beauty and the power of what we call as breath. Breath is the first thing that we do when we are born. It's called as a first breath. And the very last thing we do before we die, called as a last breath. Isn't it fascinating that the period between the first breath and the last breath is what we call as life? And breathing is equated to life. I think nothing more important than breathing to be alive. 6 million breaths every year. That's a large amount of air that we take inside our lungs. And what is interesting is, historically, breath has always been given a very, very high position. In the Egyptian period, the breath was called as ka, that's the literal word for breath, and which actually meant soul. So breath was equated to soul. Even the Greeks equated breath to soul, and they called it pneuma. The Bible also talks about breath as a mediator of transmitting the Holy Spirit. So breath is so very important, even as mentioned in the Bible. In the Hinduism, breath is equated to prana, and we know that prana is life. So breath is life. And in several other cultures, breath is equated to life, to soul, and to the divine thing that keeps us alive. Out of the three basic necessities of life, which is food, water, and air, we need about 1 to 2 kilograms of food every day. And that's the breakfast, lunch, dinner, the snack that you would have during the day. The total quantum of food that we need to eat every day is around 1 to 2 kilograms. Some of you all may eat more, or some of you all may eat less. Water, around 2 to 3 liters. And these are absolute necessities. Without food and water, we cannot live. But perhaps the most important basic necessity of life, more important than the food that we eat and the water that we drink, is the air that we breathe. And many of us perhaps may not be aware that we breathe about 10,000 liters of air every day. It is necessary to do that if we have to keep ourselves alive and to keep ourselves healthy. Oxygen is one of the most important constituents of air that keeps us alive. And it is so very important for our life to have this vital life force called oxygen. Did you know that oxygen generates 90% of our body's energy, with only 10% coming from the food that we eat and the water that we drink? That is how important is breathing. The breath that we take, the oxygen that it contains, generates 90% of our body's energy. And then some other interesting fact as well. The energy currency of the cell is called as ATP, or adenosine triphosphate. And on a daily basis, the human body needs to generate as much amount of ATP that is equivalent to your weight. So if you weigh 60 kilos or 70 kilos, your body generates 60 kilograms of ATP every single day. Obviously, it is utilized almost instantaneously by the cells. And 90% of that ATP comes from the oxygen that you breathe. In an undergraduate lecture, I was asked this question: sir, what is so special about oxygen that it generates 90% of the body's energy? And to be honest, I had to actually scratch my head. How does oxygen generate energy? Does it produce heat inside the cell? Does it burn inside the cell and produce a fire? No. I think the answer I found was in simple 7th standard chemistry. The outer ring of the oxygen molecule should have 8 electrons. but it has only 6 electrons, which means that it has 2 empty slots and therefore it can accept electrons. Accepting electrons releases energy, as simple as that. And this process occurs in the mitochondria. So the food that we eat, which contains carbohydrates or fats, is broken down by the enzymes in the cytoplasm. As the carbon gets broken down, there are a lot of electrons that are generated. These electrons are primarily formed in the mitochondria. And until somebody accepts those electrons, the energy cannot be released in the form of ATP. So it is this oxygen molecule that accepts all the electrons that are generated during the breakdown of the food that we eat. And once it accepts electrons, it releases ATP. In addition to that, your body also produces water. Other than ATP, your body produces water. And on a daily basis, your body generates 1 glass of water every day. It synthesizes water. Did you know this? Now, oxygen is necessary because it helps in the generation of energy. And here is an example. If you take 1 molecule of glucose and burn it in the absence of oxygen, which we call as anaerobic glycolysis, it generates 2 molecules of ATP. But the same molecule of glucose, when it is burned in presence of oxygen, it generates 36 molecules of ATP. And that's the amplifying power of oxygen. Fats perhaps generate the most amount of energy. 1 molecule of fat, such as palmitic acid, generates 132 molecules of ATP, but it requires a lot of oxygen. In the absence of oxygen, you cannot burn fat to generate energy. So that's how oxygen generates energy for the human body. Not only that, but if you look at the composition of the proteins and carbohydrates and fats, essential things for a survival, each one of these has an oxygen molecule inside the structure. So oxygen molecule is a constituent of all proteins, all carbohydrates, and all fats. Why that? Even water contains oxygen. In fact, 70% of your body weight is because of the oxygen that is present in your body. Obviously, most of it is because of the water content, because oxygen is very heavy, hydrogen is light. So 70% of your body weight is actually oxygen. Now, the organ that actually nourishes the body with oxygen, soaks in the oxygen that is present in the atmosphere, and then delivers it to the body, this organ is called as the lung. It's a beautiful organ. And on a daily basis, each one of us needs to burn 500 liters of oxygen. That is, if you sleep for 24 hours, you don't do any physical activity or mental activity. If you do your routine day-to-day activities, your body needs to burn 1,000 liters of oxygen, pure oxygen. And if you do regular physical exercise, your body needs to burn around 1,500 liters of oxygen. So that's the daily requirement of oxygen. It's a huge amount of requirement that the body has for oxygen. And this supply of oxygen to the human body is provided by the lung. That's the most important function of the lung. It soaks in the oxygen and delivers it to the body. In addition to that, it also excretes a very important waste product called carbon dioxide. There's no other way we can excrete carbon dioxide. And it excretes about 350 liters of carbon dioxide every day. Isn't that amazing? Look at the quantum of work that the lung does to keep us healthy and alive. So the 10,000 liters of air that we breathe, 21% of which is oxygen. So on a daily basis, we inhale about 2,100 liters of oxygen, which comes across the surface area of around 75-200 square meters, the size of a tennis court. Because the alveoli, when you open them up, they would occupy the size of a tennis court. And out of the 2,100 liters of oxygen that enter inside our lungs, the lungs soak in anywhere between 500 to 1,500 liters of oxygen. That's the efficiency of the lung in soaking up oxygen. The delivery of oxygen from the lung to all the cells of the body is made by this cell called as a red blood cell, which contains hemoglobin, packed with hemoglobin. Every red blood cell has 300 million hemoglobin molecules. It's necessary to have those many hemoglobin molecules if you have to transport 1,000 liters of oxygen on a daily basis. The red blood cell has even got rid of the nucleus, because the nucleus occupies space. It says, I don't want the nucleus. I want to utilize that space to pack in more hemoglobin. And that's why the red blood cell is an enucleated cell, primarily just dedicated for the function of transporting oxygen So it's got these hemoglobin molecules, which has got an affinity for oxygen. So the moment oxygen is delivered from the lung, it soaks in that oxygen, attaches to the hemoglobin molecule, and then it is transported to all the organs of the body. There are 25 trillion red blood cells circulating in the body at any given point of time. Isn't that amazing? Out of the 37 trillion cells that the human body is made up of, 65% are only red blood cells. Look at the amount of investment that the human body has made in order to soak in the oxygen from the air and then deliver it and transport it to all the organs of the body. Every second, 2 million red blood cells are produced, and every second, 2 million red blood cells are destroyed. This is the amazing investment that the human body has made to nourish the body with oxygen. 45 to 50% of the content of blood is oxygen, because that's the red blood cells. So if you take 100 ml of blood and just leave it for some time, the red blood cells settle at the bottom, and they occupy about 45 to 50% of the blood. And that's the one that is carrying the oxygen. So about 40 to 50% of the content of blood is also oxygen. That's the most important nutrient that the blood transports. In addition to that, the lung is a sponge-like organ that protects the heart from all the sides. So as a shock absorbent for the heart, filters of small blood clots from the veins, because all the blood flows through the lungs at some point of time. It also provides airflow for sound generation, which I'm doing. I'm talking to you because of the air that comes out of my lungs. A lot of other functions like maintaining acid-base balance, water loss, smell, and it also metabolizes a few of these chemicals, such as angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. And therefore, these are all the so-called non-respiratory functions of the lung. But this is also something that I thought was very exciting. The lung is an organ that generates or synthesizes platelets. So we know that platelets are formed in the bone marrow, but around 40 to 50% of the circulating platelets in the blood actually originate from the lung. And that's how the lung is an important source of platelets for the body. I believe this is a very interesting and very important figure. On the left-hand side is a picture of a lung. On the right-hand side, I've just inverted that. It looks like a tree, isn't it? The lungs take in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide, whereas the trees take in carbon dioxide and give out oxygen. What better example can you have than made for each other? The lungs that are there in our chest that soak in the oxygen, made for each other with the trees. The trees give us oxygen and we give them carbon dioxide. This is such a beautiful example of Mother Nature. The ancient rishis and munis knew the beauty and the power of breath. They knew the power of breathing. It's not only nourishing our body with oxygen, but the simple act of breathing also delivers the soul to your body. It also has tremendous healing powers. Breathing has healing powers. Did you know this? And there's a lot of recent research that is happening in this area of the importance of lung in the healing process of different diseases. So this is something that we know so very little about, the importance of this breath. I just got this book last week, and I would recommend you all to buy this book. It's called Breath Taking, a beautiful book on the importance of the lung, written by Dr. Michael Stephen, who is at the Jefferson University Hospitals. Just published a few months ago. I happened to see this by chance, and I got this book from Amazon. And it's important to read this because it'll make you realize how important this organ is. A beautiful book. So if you have to measure lung function, what are the questions that you need to ask? I mean, the lung performs so many different functions. On an architectural basis, the lung is made up of two components. You have the airways, which are branching, and then you have the alveoli, which are these sac-like portions, which is at the end of the small bronchiole. And those two perform different functions. So are the airways patent? Is an important functioning of the lung, because we need to find an answer for that. The airways are not patent. The airways are blocked. Obviously, that produces a disease. Two most common diseases of obstructive airway disease are asthma and COPD. So how do you find an answer for that? Are the airways patent or not? obviously these are the tools that we can use: spirometry, lung oscillometry, body plethysmography, and a peak flow meter. These are the tools that will give you the answer for this question: are the airways patent? Are the airways hypersensitive? You know that hypersensitivity of the airways is a classical feature of asthma, and how do you measure that? So you have the methacholine challenge test, and then you have the exercise challenge test. Are the airways inflamed? Because we know inflammation of the airways is a very characteristic feature of underlying asthma. We have a whole host of other diseases, but primarily asthma. How do you measure that inflammation portion of the lung? So you can measure the exhaled fractionated nitric oxide in the breath, or you could do a sputum induction and then collect the cells and then quantify the cells and measure them. Lung mechanics, you know, lung inhalation, exhalation is a very mechanical function produced by the diaphragm and the chest wall. How do you measure that? So we can measure that with the help of a body plethysmograph, which measures the PI max and the PE max. What is the total airspace volume? How many alveoli are there holding the air that we breathe? Body plethysmography that measures the total lung capacity, functional residual capacity, residual volume. You can also use a helium washout test or you can use a high resolution CT scan to measure the total airspace volume. Is the lung diffusion apparatus functioning well? You have the DNC on the 6-minute walk test that will help you find an answer for that. So measuring lung function is a composite of all these tools that I've just mentioned. So if you have put a board outside your clinic, say PFT lab, and it contains only a spirometer, it's not a PFT lab, it's a spirometry lab. If you want to really do good measurement of the lung function, you need all these tools that I've just mentioned. How did people measure lung function in the olden days? Because it's, you know, the lung is situated inside the thorax. We can't see it, we can't feel it. We can only hear with the help of a stethoscope the breath sounds. Otherwise, how do you measure whether the lung is functioning properly or not? And this is some of the very innovative ways that people actually attempted to measure the lung function. And here, as you can see, in 1875, a doctor called Dr. Bodin. So here is a rubber thing where you've got the scale over here, you blow air into it, and then this will inflate. And the quantum of inflation that happens over here, like example over here, that will tell you what is the volume of air that you could breathe. And there were so several other tools that people developed over the years. So here again, you breathe through this opens up, and then there's a scale over here that will tell you how many liters of air that you removed out from your lungs. But perhaps the best example that I can think of is Stephen Hales from the United Kingdom in 1727. Very simple logic. Take a deep breath in, take a balloon and remove all that air out that you possibly can in that balloon. You capture the air that you exhale into a balloon, and that balloon now contains a volume of air that you could remove. How do you measure that? Using Archimedes' principle. Take a tub, fill it with water. The balloon that you have just removed all the air from, put it inside the tub that is filled up to the brim, and the excess volume of water that flows out is exactly equal to the volume of air in the balloon. So you can measure that in terms of liters. So this is one of the first ways in which the amount of air that you could remove from the lungs was measured using a balloon. And then history tells us about Sir John Hutchison, who invented the spirometer. Essentially the same logic, water displacement, just like I told you with the balloon. And he called this instrument as the spirometer. So the spirometer was invented, it was there for quite a few years before, but the traditional spirometer was invented by Sir John Hutchison in 1846, more than 150 years ago, more than 170 years ago. And the same book that we read called Hutchison's Clinical Methods in second MBBS is the same Hutchison who invented the spirometer. Now, the term that he coined for that volume of air that you remove from the lungs after taking a deep inhalation, so fill your lungs with as much air as possible, remove all that volume of air that you can remove completely. That volume of air, he called it as vital capacity. And there's a very specific reason why he called it as vital capacity, because this volume of air, as he showed through his research, was vital for survival. And therefore, he called it as vital capacity. Now the vital capacity, if you remove it slowly, it was called as slow vital capacity. And if you remove the same vital capacity with force, it was called as forced vital capacity. So I've introduced to you three terms that are used in spirometry: vital capacity, slow vital capacity, forced vital capacity. Maximum volume of air that you can remove after taking a deep enough full inhalation. And he, being a doctor for life insurance, was able to show that it's a wonderful predictor of life. If you have bigger vital capacity, you will live for longer. If your vital capacity was smaller, you would die earlier. And therefore, he used this, you know, during 1846 as an important predictor of survival. How many of us use this as a predictor of survival in life insurance, the investigations that we do during that time? For 100 years, vital capacity was the only parameter that a physician measured to understand lung function. 100 years, only vital capacity. 1946, a French physician called Robert Tiffineau, he brought the time component to the spirometry. Very, very interesting. If you look at the vital capacity, whether it is slow or forced, and if you took healthy subjects or if you took people with mild to moderate airway disease, such as asthma, hardly any difference in the FVC. So FVC was not able to differentiate between healthy and diseased people. So FVC was not good. What Tiffineau said is, why don't we measure the volume of air that comes out of in the first 1 second? And that first volume of air that comes out in the first 1 second was what he called as FEV1, forced expiratory volume in the first 1 second. And he was able to show that compared to healthy people, the FEV1 value in people with obstructive airway disease was significantly lower. After 100 years, there was one additional parameter that was developed for spirometry by this French physician that helped us diagnose obstructive airway disease. Now, what should be the cutoff value to say that FEV1 upon FVC ratio is less compared to that of a normal healthy person? It was Dr. Gansler in 1951 from the United States who actually did some research to show that 70% of the FVC, more than that, was good enough to say that this is healthy. Less than 70% or less than 0.7 was indicative of obstructive airway disease. So we got a cutoff value to say that if your FEV1 upon FVC ratio is less than 0.7, then that is indicative of obstructive airway disease, such as asthma or COPD. But it, look at it, took 150 years, 120 years to arrive at this cutoff value. The logic that a spirometer uses is very simple. But here are straws. There are some straws that are thin, some straws that are big. If I ask you to take a deep breath and blow out through the small straw and then remove all the air out, and then the next time you take a bigger straw, take a deep breath and then blow out through the bigger straw, through which straw will the air come out faster? Through the small straw or through the big straw? Obviously, the air will come out faster through the big straw because you've got bigger volume of air that can flow through the tube. If you have small straw, it will take a longer time to remove that air out. And that's the fundamental principle that a spirometer uses. So here it is. Here is a composite of all the alveoli in the lung put together in one single composite alveoli. And here is the composite of all the airways present in the lung. So nice and patent airways, healthy alveoli. The person has just taken a deep inhalation, filled the lung with as much air as possible, and then blow it forcefully. See the speed with which the air comes out. Did you see that? Now compare that with a person who has got obstructive airway disease. So alveoli are the same. The airways are narrowed because of inflammation, bronchospasm, mucus present inside the lumen. So there is narrowing of the airway. Now this person takes a deep inhalation and then blows out forcefully. See the time that it takes to remove that air out. Could you appreciate the difference between a healthy person and an obstructive airway disease person? It takes longer time to empty the lungs. And if here again is just a repetition of that. And to put it in a graphical format, on the y-axis is your vital capacity that you remove with force, and therefore it's called forced vital capacity, 1 liter, 2 liters, 3 liters, and so on. The maximum volume of air that you could remove from the lungs, the highest point is what we call as FVC, that is around 4 liters. But now if I give it a time domain on the x-axis, how much volume of air did you remove in the first 1 second, in 2 seconds, in 3 seconds, in 4 seconds, and so on. Can we measure that? Yes, we can. And the volume of air that comes out in the first 1 second is called FEV1. In 2 seconds, it's called FEV2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so this is what happens in a normal healthy person. What I want you to appreciate are two things. The volume of air that you remove in the first 1 second is generally 70% of this entire FVC. And therefore, that is a cutoff value that we generally use for diagnosing obstructive airways. The second thing that I would like you to see is by around 2 seconds, all the air has already come out. After 2 seconds, because there is no more air left to come out, you get a horizontal flat line. This is what we call as a plateau. This plateau starts by around 2 or if not 3 seconds. By 2 to 3 seconds, all the air has come out. And then after that, it's a straight line called as a plateau. Now, in a person with obstructive airway disease, see that it takes a long time to empty the lungs. How would you see that in a graphical format? So FVC in a person with mild to moderate obstructive airway disease would be exactly the same as that of a normal healthy person. Therefore, it does not help you differentiate between healthy and obstructive airway disease. But see what happens to the time domain. See what happens to FEV1, FEV2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The two things I wanted you to see. The volume of air that comes out in the first 1 second is less than 70% of the FVC. And therefore, that indicates presence of obstructive airway disease. And second is, look at the amount of time that it took to remove all that air out. It took about 6 seconds. Whereas in a normal healthy person, by 2 seconds or 3 seconds, all the air has come out. There's nothing left after 3 seconds. Here, it takes 6 seconds to reach that highest point called as the FVC. If you see these graphs, if you have understood this, then it's very, very easy to interpret spirometry. There are essentially two types of spirometers. One is a volume displacement spirometer that uses water over here. And this is the one that Sir John Hutchison invented. Perhaps you may have seen this in your physiology tutorial in the first MBBS lectures in the medical college, because it's there. This water displacement spirometer is there. And the second is displacement of air in the bellows. So these are the bellows. So when you blow air into this, the bellows open up. And as they open up, this pointer moves downwards. And depending on the quantum of air that you remove, it actually moves the pointer to that section. So this is what the bellows spirometer looks like, made by Vitalograph, perhaps the most accurate spirometer that you can get. But it is huge, bulky. You have to measure the volumes with the, you know, with the scale and a pencil. And it doesn't give you a lot of other parameters, although you can derive them, such as the peak flow meter, peak expected flow rate, or the FEF 25 to 75, which I'll come in the subsequent slide. So those are the drawbacks of the volume displacement spirometer. The other spirometers that they came after the volume displacement spirometers were the flow sensor-based spirometers. And the logic that it used was very simple. If you blow at the rate of 1 liter per second, so that is a flow. Flow can be measured with a sensor. And you do that for 5 seconds. How much volume of air have you exhaled? So if you want to measure the volume of air, you need flow and you need time. And here is a very simple example. 1 liter per second for 5 seconds, you would have removed 5 liters of air. Simple logic, isn't it? Just by multiplying flow by time, it tells you the volume. Now, this is provided the volume, the flow is uniform continuously. Sadly, the volume, the flow that comes out of your lung is not a rectangle, but a triangle over here. The flow suddenly increases, reaches a peak, and then the flow reduces with time. Now, in this case, because the mathematics is not as simple as a rectangle, this was very, very complicated to measure the volume because the flows are so different across the different in your exhalation maneuver. So what people did was they broke the expiratory curve into small sections, microseconds. So what is the flow for that 1 microsecond? What is the flow for that next 1 microsecond? The flow kept on increasing up to this microsecond, and then the flow kept on reducing. So what it did was it actually added up all these flow into time is equal to volume, and that the number of times you break this up, the more accurate values that you'll get for your volume. So if you break it up with only small numbers, then the volume that you will get will perhaps be less accurate. But if you have multiple, you break it into 300 times, you know, for 5 seconds. Then it will give you more accurate values. And this is why the flow sensor based power meter requires a computer to actually calculate all these calculations to give you these graphs and the volumes. So that's how a flow sensor based power meter actually works. There are different types of flow sensors, pneumotachograph, anemometer, which measures changes in pressure, a turbine, and the ultrasonic. And I'm not going to go into the details of this, but it's important for you to at least know which is the flow sensor that my spirometer has. Is it a pneumotachograph? Is it a turbine? Or is it an ultrasonic? It's important to know that. How do you interpret spirometry? Believe me, when I was doing my MD final exam, MD in respiratory medicine at DJ Medical College in Pune, one of the, not the best, but one of the good medical colleges, I had never seen what a spirometer looked like. And I had no clue about how to interpret the spirometry report. For me, at that point of time, spirometry was the most difficult test to interpret. And I was praying to God, please don't give me a spirometry report because I will not know how to interpret. Time has changed, and because of the interest that I had in spirometry, and we did a lot of training programs, interpreting spirometry, I've realized, is so very simple. So very simple. And I'll share that secret with you. Can you all make a diagnosis on this electrocardiogram? I'm going to give you 3 seconds or 5 seconds. I'm sure some of you all have made the correct electrocardiographic diagnosis. Acute anterior wall myocardial infarction. 3 seconds, 4 seconds is good enough for some of you all to make a diagnosis. Perhaps you may be experts in ECGs. How did you make the diagnosis? When I was taught how to interpret an electrocardiogram, there were some 23 parameters or 24 parameters that you have to look into and then make an interpretation of the ECG. You made it in 3 to 4 seconds. How? Just by looking at the shape of those curves, isn't it? So if you know how to interpret the shape of those curves, you can make a diagnosis of a heart attack, a serious diagnosis of a heart attack within 3 to 4 seconds. You can make the interpretation of spirometry in the same amount of time if you know how to interpret the shape of the curve of a spirometry report. And this is how a spirometry report looks like. It gives you the flow volume loop, it gives you the volume time graph, and then it gives you all these parameters which is printed. And then looking at all this, you have to make your interpretation of the report. How many of you all can make an interpretation of this report at this point of time? If not, I'm going to share with you the secrets, how to do interpretation. So this is the volume time graph, volume in liters, time in seconds. The volume of air that you remove in the first 1 second is called FEV1. And the maximum volume of air that you remove from the lungs, this highest point is called FVC. You can see that FEV1 and FVC are very close to each other. And by around 2 seconds or 2.5 seconds, there is a plateau that follows after that. There's a flat line, which means that all the air has already come out. There's no more air left to come out. This is the shape of a curve of a normal, healthy person. Now, when this person develops mild obstructive airway disease, this is the shape of the curve. You can see that the FEV1 is slightly reduced. FVC is the same as that of a normal, healthy person. But there is a difference over here. See how much time it took to reach the plateau. These are around 5 to 6 seconds, isn't it? So normal FVC, slightly low FEV1, and a plateau that is reached by around 4 to 5 seconds is indicative of mild obstructive airway disease. Now, when this disease becomes moderate obstructive airway disease, this is the shape of the curve. FEV1 becomes even more reduced. FVC still remains the same as that of a normal healthy person, but there is no plateau for even up to 6 seconds. The air comes out, but it takes 6 seconds for all the air to come out. So no plateau over here. At least in mild, there is a plateau towards the end. In severe disease, or very severe disease, this is the shape of the curve. The FEV1 is significantly reduced. FVC is also significantly reduced. But what is more important than all this is look at the line that seems to be going up and up and up forever, as if it will keep on going forever. Now, the reason why you get a low FVC value in patients with severe obstructive airway disease is in patients with severe obstructive airway disease, when you start blowing forcefully, the small airways collapse. And the air that is distilled to the small airways, which is in the alveoli, remains trapped inside the lung. That volume of air doesn't come out. It's not picked up by the flow sensor of the spirometer. And therefore, you get a low FVC. The low FVC is because of air trapping. So severe obstructive airway disease, significantly low FEV1, low FVC, and a line that keeps on going up and up forever. This is severe or very severe obstructive airway disease. Isn't it simple? If you know how to look at the shape of the curve, you can make a diagnosis and you can even tell the severity of the disease. The flow volume loop is even simpler than that. This is the flow volume loop. So flow on the y-axis, volume on the x-axis. In the earlier graph, volume was on the y-axis. Now the volume is on the x-axis. So the maximum volume of air that you remove from the lungs is called FVC. This is the highest point. And the maximum flow that you reach on the flow axis, which is the y-axis, this highest point is called as the peak expiratory flow rate, PEFR, the same value that you get with a peak flow meter. So as you can see that the flow suddenly increases, reaches a peak, and then from the peak to the FVC, it's a straight line, as if it's drawn with a scale, as straight as that. The expiratory curve looks like a triangle, and the inspiratory curve looks like a semicircle. This is the inspiratory curve, okay? If this is what a normal healthy person shows, this is the shape of the curve of a normal healthy person. Mild obstructive airway disease is this, normal peak flow, normal FVC. But then what's the difference? The difference is in the straightness of this line. From PEFR to FVC, there's a mild concavity over here. This concavity, presence of concavity indicates presence of airflow obstruction, for sure. Okay? With normal peak flow, normal FVC, it's mild obstructive airway disease. Low peak flow, low PEFR values, normal FVC, moderate obstructive airway disease. And in severe or very severe obstructive airway disease, you can see that the peak flow value has reduced, FVC value has reduced, and I told you why the FVC value reduces in severe obstructive airway disease, because of air trapping. But look at the curve over here. Instead of being a straight line, you know, like a straight line, it's now become a 90 degree curve. This is indicative of severe or very severe airflow obstruction. So just by looking at the shape of these curves, you can make a diagnosis of obstructive airway disease, and you can even tell what the severity of the problem is. Now, before we really look at the shape of these curves, it's very, very important to ensure that the scale that is used in preparing these graphs is appropriate. So you can see in the flow volume loop, 0.5 is the 0.5 liters is equal to the flow of 1 liter per second. So what does it mean over here? X is to Y is 0.5 is to 1. Whereas in the volume time graph, 1 second is equal to 2 liters of air. So this is 1:2. The ratio is the same in the flow volume loop and the volume time graph, but you have to make sure that the scale that they have used is correct. Because if they use the wrong scale, the shape looks completely different and you may make a wrong diagnosis. And I really burnt my fingers in one such exercise where a new spirometer was used in a very large epidemiological study. And we were doing the quality assurance for that. And we were just not getting a plateau in any of those reports. It was just a line that kept on going up and up forever, even in all healthy people. So we were a little worried. And it is only after some time that we realized that the software that was used to make these graphs, they use a wrong scale. And the moment you use a wrong scale, you get different shapes of the curve. And therefore, you should not make a diagnosis based on the shape of the curve if the scales are not appropriate. So please remember that if you have to make a diagnosis on the scales, then on the shape of the curves, then the scale has to be right. This is the shape of a curve in a restrictive lung disease. So this is a normal healthy person. In a restrictive lung disease, you can see that the PFR value is less, FVC value is less, and from PFR to FVC, it's a straight line. So it's a miniature normal graph. This is what is classically seen in a patient suggestive of restrictive lung disease. And in a volume time graph, you can see that the FEV1 is less, FVC is less, but this is just like a miniature normal. So restrictive lung disease is like this. Obstructive lung disease is always accompanied with a concavity from the PEFR to FVC, always. You can also diagnose large airways obstruction by looking at the shape of the curve. You don't need FEV1 values, you don't need FVC value, but just looking at the shape of these curves. So remember, I told you that the expiratory curve is a triangle. It's one that goes suddenly up and then goes down with a straight line over here. And then inspiratory is like a semicircle. If you see this kind of a curve with the best possible effort, then you know that this is a patient who has got fixed airflow obstruction, which could either be intrathoracic or extrathoracic. So whether it's a thyroid pressing the trachea or it's a tracheal stenosis lower down inside the thorax, it'll all produce a circular shape of a graph. if there is extra thoracic obstruction, then the inspiratory curve becomes smaller. If it's an intrathoracic obstruction, then the expiratory curve becomes almost dome-shaped like this. Now, how did I remember this? So intrathoracic is expiratory, extrathoracic is inspiratory, snoring. Snoring is because of your upper airways. So snoring happens only during inspiration. So blockage during inspiration is extrathoracic. So here it is. Blockage during inspiration, yeah, this is extrathoracic. So the inspiratory curve becomes small, small size, whereas the expiratory curve is normal. Whereas if you have intrathoracic obstruction inside the thorax, whether it be at the lower end of the trachea or in the bronchial, a bronchial obstruction, then you'll get the expiratory curve that is dome-shaped. Otherwise, you get the inspiratory curve that is dome-shaped with extrathoracic. So there's a simple algorithm to use the values that are printed. So for example, FEV1 upon FVC and FVC percentage predicted. Based on only these two parameters, you can categorize your patient into one of these four boxes: normal spirometry, indicative of restrictive lung disease. Remember that spirometry can never confirm restrictive lung disease. It can only suggest you that there is suggestion of an restrictive lung disease. And for that, you need to do total lung capacity using body box or helium dilution. You cannot confirm a diagnosis of restrictive lung disease on spirometry. Please remember this. And then the third box is obstructive airway disease, which is mild or moderate severity. And then the last box is obstructive airway disease of severe obstruction, or it's a combination of obstructive and restrictive lung disease. So how do you categorize your patient into these four boxes based on only two parameters, FEV1 upon FVC and FVC percentage predicted? So if your FEV1 upon FVC ratio is more than 70%, more than 0.7, and the FVC percentage predicted is more than 80, then this is normal spirometry. If your ratio is more than 70% or more than 0.7, but the FVC is less than 0.8, or less than 80%, then this is suggestive of restrictive lung disease. If your ratio is less than 70%, then it is obstructive airway disease for sure. Okay, look at the FVC percentage predicted. If the FVC percentage predicted is more than 80%, which is normal, then this is mild or moderate obstructive airway disease. If the FVC is less than 80% predicted with a ratio of less than 0.7, then this is indicative of either severe obstructive airway disease or a combination of restrictive and obstructive lung disease. Remember the graphs I showed you? With severe obstruction, the air trapping occurs and therefore the FVC percentage predicted becomes less. And that's how the algorithm is actually based on. The moment you make a diagnosis of obstructive airway disease, the next step is to understand whether this is reversible or not reversible, or poorly reversible. Is that obstructive airway disease reversible or not reversible? And the second question that you have to ask is, how severe is the obstructive airway disease? Is it mild or moderate or severe? Now, for the severity, you use the FEV1 percentage predicted value. And for asthma, you have the 60-80 rule. For COPD, you have the 30-50-80 rule. What does this mean? If there is presence of obstructive airway disease, which you have labeled as asthma, if the FEV1 percentage predicted is more than 80, it is mild asthma. Between 60 to 80 is moderate asthma. Less than 60 is severe asthma. Okay. For COPD, we have an additional additional criteria. So more than 80 is mild, 50 to 80 is moderate, 30 to 50 is severe, and less than 30 is very severe COPD. So this is the classification of COPD based on FEV1 percentage predicted values. Now, how do you do the reversibility? The reversibility is made only with FEV1 value. You give the patient a short-acting bronchodilator like salbutamol in a dose of 2 to 4 puffs, or you can give ipratropium, or you can give a combination of both of these. And then you wait for 15 to 20 minutes and then repeat the spirometry. So you do two spirometry tests, pre-bronchodilator, post-bronchodilator after 15 to 20 minutes. If the FEV1 improves by more than 12% and more than 200 ml, this is indicative of good bronchodilator reversibility in adults. In children, you don't look at the 200 ml. You only say if the improvement is by more than 12%, that is indicative of good bronchodilator reversibility. You don't need the 200 ml criteria. Now, remember that it is and, not this or this. It is both 12% and 200 ml. If that improvement occurs, then it is indicative of good bronchodilator reversibility. Now, one secret that I wanted to share with you is that if the FVC improves more than the FEV1 after giving a bronchodilator, FVC 600 ml, FEV1 150 ml, what does this mean? It means that the small airways have actually opened. And because the small airways have opened, the air that was trapped inside comes out. And therefore, you get an increase in FVC. So if the FVC improves more than the FEV1, it indicates opening of the small airways obstruction and likely to be COPD. In fact, I use this as a guiding parameter to say that there is obstructive airway disease. Greater improvement in FEV1 is likely to be asthma. Greater improvement in FVC is likely to be COPD. And obviously, you use all the clinical parameters as well to arrive at a final diagnosis. But these are secrets that I wanted to share with you. Now, until recently, the simplified version of interpretation was, if the ratio is less than 70% or less than 0.7, this is obstructive airway disease. After giving a bronchodilator, if the ratio which was less than 70 now becomes more than 70, it indicates asthma. And if the ratio which was less than 70 remains less than 70 after giving a bronchodilator, then this is called a COPD. In fact, COPD defining criteria was a post-bronchodilator FEV1 upon FVC ratio less than 0.7 or less than 70%. If you consider only the pre-bronchodilator value, then it could either be asthma or it could be COPD. After giving a bronchodilator, see what happens to the ratio. And that will help you differentiate between asthma and COPD. In fact, this was the this was the defining criteria for COPD. But let us not only look at this. You have to look at the whole picture. Presence of obstructive airway disease on spirometry, but you'd also look for presence of respiratory symptoms and exposure to risk factors that could explain that that obstructive airway disease. Look at the whole picture and then you arrive at the final diagnosis. Now, for a long period of time, this was what was used as the cutoff value to say this is obstructive and this is not obstructive, 70% or less than 0.7. A very, very interesting study published in JAMA in 2015, so 6 years ago, called as the COPD gene study. So it's a fantastic study. It's a longitudinal cohort of more than 10,000 smokers who were followed over a period of at least 10 years. And then those 10,000 smokers, how many of them had COPD on spirometry was what they measured. But in addition to that, they also did high resolution CT scans, HRCTs, to see, is there any radiological evidence of emphysema, air trapping, or airflow obstruction? And what they reported was something very, very interesting. So these are just the images of how a normal HRCT looks like. If it's no obstruction, no air trapping, it looks green. If it's COPD bronchitis type, if there is airflow obstruction, small airways obstruction, you start getting these yellow shades. And if it is red, then this is alveolar wall destruction or what we call as emphysema. So you can use an HRCT to actually understand what is a component of obstruction and what is a component of damage and destruction of the alveoli. And what they found was something very interesting. Normal spirometry, ratio of FEV1 upon FVC more than 0.7, but HRCT showing significant evidence of COPD, alveolar wall destruction, small airways obstruction, and air trapping. In fact, 54% of the smokers with normal spirometry had at least one or more respiratory related impairment on HRCT. So what it means is something very, very important. Around 40% or 42% of the people who were smokers who had normal spirometry, you would label them as normal, but on HRCT, there is evidence of COPD. That is the amount of underdiagnosis that occurs because of spirometry. Now, this came as a bit of a surprise because for all these years, we believed that spirometry was the gold standard diagnostic test. That was a reference test to say whether you have COPD or don't have COPD. There's nothing better than a spirometer. But now, as the HRCT has improved, the software has improved, now we can see that even in the absence of any obstructive airway disease on spirometry, you can still see presence of COPD on that. So which means that COPD probably is underdiagnosed if you use only spirometry as a diagnostic tool. So here is a COPD iceberg. Diagnosed by symptoms, diagnosed by spirometry, but there's a significant proportion of COPDs who will have normal spirometry. Now, how do you diagnose these people? So this was a debate that has been going on for a long time. FEF 25 to 75% is the average flow between 25% of the FVC to 75% of the FVC. Say, for example, this is your FVC up to here. Middle portion will be 50%, half of that would be 25%, and the half of over here will be 75%. So you draw a line up over here from 25 to 75, and the average flow on the y-axis between 25% of the FVC to 75% of the FVC, this portion, the average flow, is called as FEF 25 to 75. Now, FEF 25 to 75 clearly indicates that this air is coming from the small airways. So if you have small airways obstruction, you will get a nice concavity over here, which means that the FEF 25 to 75 values have reduced. Now, personally, I like to use FEF 25 to 75 as a reasonably good marker, either of early obstructive airway disease, such as early asthma or early COPD, when you have normal FEV1-FVC ratio, normal FEV1, normal FVC. If you have a low FEF 25 to 75, it's good enough for me to suggest that there is a presence of small airways obstruction. But it is not as robust as the FEV1 and the FVC values. So if you do the spirometry repeatedly, your FEV1 values will be very close to each other. The FVC values will be very close to each other. So there's not much difference whether you blow 3 times or 5 times. Whereas in FEF 25 to 75, you get a big variability between the first reading and the second reading and the third reading. And therefore, because of this big variability, FEF 25 to 75 has not been recommended as a useful parameter to diagnose small airways obstruction. However, if you are confident that your FVC is reliable, and if you're confident that the patient gave a good effort, so there's a nice peak, and the patient removed all the air out. On the volume time graph, there's a nice flat curve over there, which means that the patient has removed all the air out. FVC has been achieved, and there's a good effort. Then I tend to rely on the FEF 25 to 75. Imagine if this patient removed less FVC out, less amount of air out. FVC was low. So this point would go to the left axis over here. With the same peak flow, with a reduced volume, the FEF 25 to 75 would shift to the left, and it would actually go higher up. So person with small airways obstruction, if that person does not remove all the air out, you will get a false increase in FEF 25 to 75. Similarly, if the peak flow value, the patient does not give a good effort, and if there's a blunting of there's a dome-shaped curve over here, low peak flow, then your FEF 25 to 75 again shifts. And that is the reason why people do not like FEF 25 to 75. But as I said, if you're confident that the FVC is reliable and the peak flow is a good effort, then I would use FEF 25 to 75 as a useful marker of early asthma, early COPD, or indicative of small airways obstruction. The cutoff value for that is 65%, less than 65% predicted. Ratio for adults is more than 70 for healthy. For FEV 25 to 75, more than 65% is healthy. And if you want to look at a good bronchodilator reversibility in the small airways, then you have to look for an improvement of at least 25% improvement in FEV 25 to 75% to say significant bronchodilator response in the small airways. Okay? Not the 12% and the 200 ml that you get in FEV1 change. Now, Surya Bhatt is an Indian origin chest physician based in the US in Birmingham. And he has been instrumental in some very, very eminent work, very classical work that he's done in this field of spirometry. What he was able to show is something very interesting. The same COPD gene cohort that I mentioned to you, where HRCT was done. Look at the FEV1 upon FVC ratios over here on the x-axis. So 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8. 0.7 is a cutoff value that we use to say anything that is less than this is obstructive airway disease. Anything that is more than this is healthy. That's how we define, isn't it? 0.7. Now, he was able to show that if you use this 0.7, there is a significant number of people on the right of that. Each dot is a steady subject over here. So a significant number of people had evidence of emphysema on HRCT. A significant number of people had evidence of air trapping on COPD, on HRCT, despite having normal ratio. So the F1 upon FVC ratio of 0.7, is this really reliable to pick up emphysema, to pick up airflow obstruction? HRCT is showing that even if you have a ratio which is more than 0.7, and that's the new information, that the new knowledge that we have developed over the last few years, the ratio may not be necessarily accurate. A significant number of people will still continue to have COPD despite having a normal F1 upon FVC ratio. We all know that the F1 upon FVC ratio reduces with time. And therefore, if you use the cutoff of 70%, there is a possibility of underdiagnosis of COPD in the younger age group. And this is the age on the x-axis. And in the elderly people, you will overdiagnose COPD if you use the cutoff value of 70%. Now, that's a problem. And because of this, many people suggested that we should use the lower limit of normal rather than the fixed ratio of 0.7 to define presence of obstruction, of fixed airflow obstruction, if the post-bronchodilator is less than 0.7. Now, so should we use 0.7 or should we use the lower limit of normal? Was a very important research question that Surya Bhatt asked, and that is published in JAMA, a very, very prominent medical journal from the US, published a couple of years ago in 2019. Where he did a head-to-head comparison between LLN and a fixed ratio of 0.7. But the output that he looked was how many of these patients need hospitalization, how many of them die. So these are very hard clinical endpoints, much more important than the symptoms that you would have. So using these hard endpoints, he was able to show that the ratio of 0.7 is actually better than the lower limit of normal. So this is the Udine's index on the y-axis. The Udine's index is a composite of sensitivity, specificity, positive predicted value, negative predicted value. The higher it is, the better it is. So the fixed ratio of 0.7 was higher than the LLN that you can see over here. So what he went on to argue was, if you have to choose between a fixed ratio of 0.7 and LLN, it is better to choose the fixed ratio. Because it is easy, and in fact, it gives you more sensitivity, specificity, positive predictive value, negative predictive value. If you are measuring hospitalization rates and mortality in patients of obstructive airway disease, so I think this was a very useful paper. That for me, it tells me the fixed ratio of 0.7 seems to be useful. You don't need to use the LLN. Then a few years ago, the same group actually showed a very novel parameter on spirometry that was suggesting earlier airflow obstruction in the presence of a normal F1 upon FVC ratio. Forced expiratory volume in 3 seconds divided by forced expiratory volume in 6 seconds. If you use this ratio, and if you have the lower limit of normal, if it is less than the lower limit of normal, you will pick up all the early cases of COPD, which the fixed ratio of 0.7 was not able to pick up. And obviously, they use this by looking at the HRCT values. So again, this seems to be a new parameter that we could potentially use. But for that, we need to have normal values, normal predicted values for FEV3 and FEV6 to then get the lower limits of normal for each of these. And that's a problem in our country. But in the US, where they have reasonably good predicted values, you can use this new parameter to define early COPD. And then this is another paper that was just published a couple of months ago in CHEST that looked at, should we use the F1 upon FVC ratio or can we use the SVC instead of FVC? We all know that in patients with COPD, where the small airways obstruction occurs, when they start blowing forcefully, the small airways collapse and then air distant to that cannot come out. So an FVC value becomes less. The ratio then becomes higher. F1 upon FVC ratio becomes higher. Now that can be overcome by doing an FEV1 maneuver and then by doing an SVC maneuver. Now, which one is better? Is an F1 upon SVC maneuver better than F1 upon FVC maneuver in differentiating, in picking up COPD? And this is a paper that actually showed that F1 upon SVC seems to be a more useful parameter, a more reliable parameter to diagnose COPD then FVC, then F1 upon FVC ratio. So I think this is going to change practice in the forthcoming years. So if you have to now start doing spirometry in COPD patients, do two maneuvers. A forceful maneuver to get the first FEV1 value. You don't need to go to FVC. And then you do a second maneuver with slow vital capacity. And if the ratio is more than point, if the ratio is less than 0.7, then this is strongly suggestive of underlying COPD. So that's how the ratios have now changed. Which should be the cutoff value for defining obstructive airway disease in children? FEV1 upon FVC for adults is 0.7. For children, should we use 0.7 itself? And that is what the NICE guidelines in the UK actually recommended for a long time. They recommended a cutoff value of 0.7 for children less than 18 as a cutoff value for obstructive airway disease. But the GINA guidelines have suggested that you should use a ratio of 0.9, 90%. Now, whom should we rely on? We know GINA is perhaps an international body, therefore more reliable. And there were two very recent studies that looked at the sensitivity, specificity, positive predicted value, negative predicted value of these two cutoff values. And they were able to show that this is a useless cutoff value for children. This is a little higher. So they were recommending that it should be less than 0.85 as a cutoff value to define obstructive airway disease in children. And a paper that we just published in Lung India just about a month ago, a very, very large study in about 3,000 plus children from Delhi, Kottayam, Mysuru. And we use that as an opportunity to check what is the adequate cutoff value on FEV1 upon FVC that gives us this reasonably good clinical parameters, cough, shortness of breath, wheezing, and so on. And we were able to find in this study that a cutoff value of 0.85 seems to be the most appropriate cutoff value for children. So here is a new information for you. If you're doing spirometry in children less than 18, the cutoff value that you should use for obstructive airway disease is 0.85. For adults, 0.7. Now the new spirometers, the new spirometer reports have come up with a new parameter called Z-score. Now this is a normal bell-shaped curve. So you have the maximum people in the middle and then lesser people on each side of the curve. So if it is a normally distributed curve, then you have one standard deviation, two standard deviations, and so on. So if you go up to minus 1.64 standard deviation, anything that is to the left of this is what we would call as abnormal. Anything that is to the right of this is what we would call as normal. This minus 1.64, which is a standard deviation, is also called as lower limit of normal. So the LLN is Z value of minus 1.64. Anything that is to the negative of this is abnormal. Now, all spirometry reports are now being reported with the Z score. So it's important for you to at least know what a Z score is. So here is a normal bell-shaped curve. This is minus 1.64. This is the value for minus 1.64, which is the LLN. If you are less than that, it is abnormal. Now here, this value is exactly in the middle. So this is normal. FVC is normal. FEV1 is normal. The ratio is normal. It's not on the left side of minus 1.64. So this is how the interpretation is done. Here you can see this person's FVC. So this is the minus 1.64. This is getting more negative. FEV1 is at this point and the ratio is over here. After giving a bronchodilator, look at the FEV1 value, which was more towards the negative, has now moved more towards the LLN. So there's some improvement over here and also some improvement in FVC over here. So bronchodilator response is also will now be represented by the Z scores, which I think all of you must know. Traditionally, this is how we diagnose obstructive airway disease. Red is pre-bronchodilator, blue is post-bronchodilator, predicted FEV1, predicted FVC. What is the diagnosis? Red is pre-bronchodilator, so low FEV1, fairly normal FVC, plateau not reached even up to 6 seconds. So this is moderate obstructive airway disease. After giving a bronchodilator, wow, there's a nice big improvement in FEV1. If you look at the scale, it's about half a liter of improvement in FEV1 over here and some improvement in FVC. So this is good moderate obstructive airway disease with good bronchodilator reversibility. You can see the same over here. Almost near normal FVC, but a low peak flow, nice concavity. This is indicative of moderate obstructive airway disease. After giving a bronchodilator, the peak flow values improve. And the FEV 25 to 75 also, you can see, gets better after giving a bronchodilator. So what is this indicative of? Asthma. Now, this is another graph, pre-bronchodilator, post-bronchodilator. You can see the FEV1 value is significantly reduced. FVC value is also significantly reduced. And the line seems to be going up and up forever. So this is severe obstructive airway disease or very severe obstructive airway disease. Does this improve after giving a bronchodilator? No change at all over here. See the right angle that is formed over here. Low FVC value because of air trapping. Low FVC value because of air trapping. And then the nice right angle over here is indicative of severe obstructive airway disease with no bronchodilator response, suggesting of COPD. So traditionally, this is how we should diagnose asthma and COPD. The last slide, just before I finish, I thought quality assurance of spirometry is a very, very important component before you do any interpretation. Because if the test is not done correctly, you will invariably make a wrong diagnosis completely. So please learn how to do quality assurance of your spirometry reports. And here is one such report. This is the expiratory curve, inspiratory curve. You can see that the FVC is always the expiratory part. So FVC is equal to FEVC, forced expiratory vital capacity, 2.94. And the inspiratory capacity, which is more than the FVC, 3.28. So this clearly means that this is about 350 ml more FIVC than FVC. What does this mean? This means that the person had not taken a deep enough inhalation before doing the forceful exhalation. And therefore, this would give you wrong diagnosis. So please, I think this is one of the most common mistakes that I've seen in spirometry all over the world, not only in India, but across. Patient is not taking a deep enough inhalation before doing the expiratory maneuver. And when he does the inspiratory maneuver, it goes much beyond the starting point over here. So this volume of FVC is lost because the patient did not take a deep enough inhalation. So this, I would not interpret this report. Others, it will give me a wrong diagnosis. I'm sure all of you all must, those of you all who know spirometry would have picked up the problem over here. So there's a dome shaped over here. So there's poor effort. And then you can see these serrations over here. What is this indicative of? Cough. So cough during spirometry we should avoid that interpretation, especially if it is before 1 second. So two mistakes over here, poor effort and a cough. And this is the third one that I wanted you all to interpret. What is the problem with this graph over here? So you can see that the expiratory curve reaches a nice peak. There's a nice descent. And then there are these. And then the inspiratory curve is before the starting point. So I'm not worried about the FIVC being more than FVC. What is the problem over here? Now, we had taught a group of how to do spirometry. And we spent all the time in training them. But this is the kind of graph that they generated. This is multiple breaths. So especially if it reaches the bottom line, the baseline, and then on top of that, there are big mountain followed by multiple small mountains. It means the person did multiple breaths. And this can be easily picked up by the shape of this curve over here. Just to suggest that quality assurance of spirometry is a very important component of doing spirometry. So I'm going to stop over here, and I hope that this was useful for you all. I know I probably went a little over time, but my sincere apologies for that. Dr. Chhabra, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Salvi. It was a brilliant lecture and thoroughly enjoyed. And I'm sure everybody would have enjoyed, coming from a master's. And the range of your presentation leaves me simply speechless. You started with the very, very basics, absolutely basics. As if you're teaching to a person who has for the first time understood what is the term spirometry. And you have gone to the currently debatable hot topic in spirometry. Extremely, I'm sure you have done justice to Dr. Bhattacharya's demand about this lecture. It should be different from what we have normally been talking about. Talk about spirometry, then the real physiology, the technology involved, and the quality control issues are so complex that it's really a difficult topic. And that is why doing good spirometry is really difficult. But Dr. Salvi has really made it very interesting. And as initiation into this area for residents especially, I'm sure they will be tempted to learn more about spirometry and then do spirometry as it should be done. The slides were very beautiful, very nice illustrations. Text was very impressive. And so thoroughly enjoyed. couple of things that you did mention about SBC rather than FBC. Yes. I'm reminded of a paper in 2005 which I had published in the Journal of Asthma, where I had shown that FE1 upon SBC is more sensitive to pick up this. Some of the, you know, a couple of other papers at that time, but then this gets lost in the mound of literature that is there. It's an evolving area, definitely, and that is why we have these guidelines coming up from time to time, and I'm sure we'll hear more about this. So I'll just go on to some of the questions that we have received. There is a question from Ashish Sinha. Sir, please explain the different shape of curves in inspiration and expiration. Normal spirometry, why there's triangle in expiration and a half circle in inspiration?
So I'm sure you'll be able to answer that better, but I'll make an attempt. So when you're taking, so if you look at the anatomy or the architecture of the lung, you have a big central trachea, which is a big starting airway, and it keeps on branching like the branches of a tree until it reaches the alveoli. So when you take an inhalation, then there's so much of space for air to go inside, and therefore you get a nice semicircle when you take an inspiratory curve. Now, when you're forcefully exhaling, all the airways get compressed, and therefore air essentially first comes out from the large airways, the medium-sized airways, the small-sized airways. The flow rates are very different. So initially you get a nice peak, and then you get slow as the flow reduces as the air comes from the bottom of the lung. So that's why you get these different shapes. Sir, if you can add anything to this.
No, I think you have done very well. That's it. Another question, I think we didn't really go into the current standardization. Somebody's, Dr. Banerjee, is asking about acceptability and repeatability criteria.
So that is something that I would have covered, but then it would have been a very big talk. So acceptability and repeatability are a criteria for quality assurance. It is an absolute must and a necessity to do quality assurance. The start should be good. There should be a good effort. And what do you mean by good effort? See, if you see the loop flow volume loop, the expiratory is a nice triangle. So if you see a nice dome-shaped curve, either that is that because of intrathoracic obstruction, fixed airflow obstruction, or the patient is not given a good effort. So how do you ensure that the patient is given a good effort? You see a nice peak. Chonch dikhni chahiye. You know, the beak of a bird. You should be able to see a nice acute angle over here. If you can see that acute angle, it means that the patient has given a good effort. So good start, good effort, slow, nice, smooth descent, no cough. There should be no glottic closure or obstruction, you know, because of the tongue blocking the mouthpiece, or you'll get a sudden fall in the flow at the end of your expiration. And then your FIVC being more than your FVC. These are the important quality assurance things that you look for. Repeatability means the difference between the highest and the second highest FEV1 and FVC should be less than 150 ml. If it is more than 150 ml, then you will never be confident whether the patient is the best. Maybe there's a possibility that he could have done more than that. And therefore, a combination of acceptability and repeatability is what we use for quality assurance.
One question, I think you did explain your talk. The increase in FVC post-bronchotic indicating COPD and increase in FE1 suggesting asthma. Little elaboration on that.
Yes. So asthma is a disease that can affect all the portions of the airways. Large size, medium size, small size, small airways, all the three portions. COPD primarily affects only the small airways, primarily, most of the time. So there is more small airway involvement in COPD than in asthma. And therefore, when you give a bronchodilator, when the medium size airway is open, when the large size airway is open, you get a nice big improvement in FEV1. Whereas in COPD, because it's a small airway, the distal portion of the lung, they get blocked. And because of the blockage, there is air trapping that occurs in the alveoli. And when you open the small airways with a bronchodilator, then the FVC actually becomes much bigger in patients of COPD. So, as I said, I use that as one of my secret criteria to differentiate between asthma and COPD.
What about correct reference equations?
Who better than Dr. Chhabra to tell us what are the most reliable reference equations for our country? Dr. Chhabra has been instrumental in developing these reference equations for the four different zones of our country, north, south, east, west. I believe Dr. Chhabra has already published two out of these four, and there are, I think, two more that are yet to be published. But in my opinion, they will be the most reliable and the most authentic reference equations for our country. So if you want to add anything to that?
Yes, I think, and these equations, these follow the current standardization protocols. Unlike some of the older papers, which were following 1987 or the 1991 protocols, at least we have the current equations, and these are available in some of the machines which we are using now. What about your favorite area, impulse oscillometry? Its role as a clinical tool.
So I showed you data suggesting that spirometry will underdiagnose COP. If you compare that with high resolution CT scans. So spirometry now will not be the gold standard diagnostic test in the future. Although, because as of now, that's the only one that we have, and therefore it remains the gold standard diagnostic test. But in the future, as as we get something closer to what we find in HRCTs, that will become the norm, that will become the gold standard. And I believe that, especially in patients with COPD for small airways obstruction, lung oscillometry such as FOT or IOS will be more sensitive than spirometry to pick up those conditions. So it's just a matter of time. I think in the next few years, we will find an answer for that, whether IOS or FOT is more reliable than spirometry in picking up early COPD, at least early COPD. So I think time will tell that.
A lot of questions are about issues which you have explained very well in that talk. So I think we will not. Otherwise, there are lots of compliments and accolades. Lots of them. So that's about it, I think. So a wonderful lecture, Dr. Salvi, enjoyed thoroughly. And so I'll hand over to Dr. Bhattacharya for his finishing comments. Dr. Bhattacharya, please.
So I'm really obliged. It's an absolutely wonderful talk. And I congratulate both Chhabra sir and my dear friend Sandeep for such a wonderful deliberation. It will be eye-opening for a lot of clinicians, and I'm sure they will remember this talk for a long, long time to come. So I'll be keeping it for everybody to replay and learn more. And I express my heartfelt gratitude to Sandeep for such a wonderful discourse. So with that, I want to close from my end. Next week, I just want to tell my audience that we'll have a session on hypoxemia, and I welcome everybody to be present. I believe that will also be a very interesting and exciting session. So back to you, sir, Dr. Chhabra.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya, and I think it's time to say goodbye. So goodbye, Dr. Salvi, and thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya, and good night.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, bye-bye.
So much, thank you.
Thank you, Sandeep.
Thank you.
Great.